good evening, and welcome back to Inside Creative Writing. I'm Robert Olin Butler, and this is my office at Florida State University. I teach here in the Graduate of Creative Writing program. And this evening, I think, is our, I believe this is our seventh session, if my memory serves correctly. We are in the process here of creating a short story from scratch with literary ambitions, and doing it on a webcast so that you can see every tiny decision that's made in this creative process. That's not the royal we that I was using there. I have come to feel as if that you who are watching are actually part of this process. In a way, I've come to understand that that the articulation I am making as I go here of the process is based on a projection of you as a kind of other self. And I'm talking to you, but in a way I'm talking to myself also. And I will again stress that I am talking to myself in a way that that is a little deceptive, and I think it's important that I continue to remind you of this. What you will see tonight is a writer creating a short story, just as I would, in the privacy of my own study. The words that I speak, the analytical words, the words of reflection and commentary on the decisions I make and on occasionally the process that I'm aware of or making myself aware of, that I'm trying to explain to you, that's going on beneath the things that I do. All of that is, in a certain sense, quite artificial. That is the articulation of it. What you hear from me are words that reflect the movement of a mind, of a conscious, indeed a self-conscious, analytical, idea-making, abstracting mind. But it's important for you to remember always that that implication about the process is the artificial thing here. That my analysis, my interpretation of what I'm doing, my commentary, is a kind of translating process. I'm putting these abstract terms, an awareness, intellectual awareness, of what in fact is, at its heart, and in the privacy of my own study, much more exclusively, a deeply irrational process, a non-intellectual process. You need to understand that artists are not intellectuals. Artists are sensualists. We understand the world only through the creation of objects that stories and novels that are intended to be and whose life is rooted primarily in the senses. All art objects are sensual objects. You would never question this in other art forms. dance and music and the cinema and painting. Those objects are entirely sensual things. Even the thing that we call abstract painting is not abstract at all. It's color and form, which are sensual things. But literary art is often subject to a unique kind of confusion by those who wish to practice it, who aspire to do it, by those who teach it, and teach it both as a literary form, that is teaching literature, or even many times who teach it as a creative form, who teach writing. And that unique confusion comes from the fact that in those other art forms, the very media that they are consisting of, sound and music and movement and dance and color and form and painting and visual images in motion in the cinema, the media there are entirely and inescapably sensual. And so there's no confusion about what the object's innate reality is. It's a sensual object. But the same principle and the same reason for being applies to the work of literature as well. A novel, a short story, these are objects who, when we read them, have a direct sensual impact on us. But the confusing thing for novels and short stories is that the medium, language, words, is not inescapably and innately and exclusively a sensual. These are not sensual things innately and exclusively. Words are made by the use of sound, certainly, but that's a very secondary property to many, many words, perhaps most words in the English language. Those words are primarily used, many of them, and the ways in which we use words are frequently in order to analyze and abstract, to explain, to summarize, to generalize, to interpret. The medium itself, language, is not innately and inescapably sensual. It is often abstract. It is often analytical. And this is why there's a confusion. Because the aspiring writer sits down and sits down from a personal history in which she has always used language in these non-sensual ways. And indeed, the non-sensual use of language has been one of the main defense mechanisms for the aspiring writer throughout her life. A defense mechanism from the terrors and the horrors and the roilings of her unconscious in her dream space. And that's true for all of us. Emotions, which are entirely sensual, are easier to deal with, are easier to control if we abstract them, if we stop responding to them and feeling the response through the senses, but pull our emotions up through, up into our minds, and we speak of them in abstract and analytical ways. We distance ourselves. We take the juice out of that emotion. And if we've protected ourselves in that way for so long, and also if we've learned to read that way, if we've been in literature classes where analysis seemed to be not a secondary thing in order to help us tune up our sensually responsive aesthetic instruments, but indeed seemed to be the fulfillment of the final step of the artistic process, where the analysis was the thing that the book intended all along, which is not the case. When you've learned literature like that, and when you have your own self-defense mechanisms in place that are based on moving your sensual experience of the world up into abstract and analytical thought and language in order to keep it safe and manageable, when you come to your writing space with all of that, and you sit down to create an art object, and the medium itself has all these other non-sensual uses attached to it, it's not surprising that one of the primary problems of all aspiring writers, and indeed it's a primary problem for even established writers, we have to work against this all the time. You've seen it in some of the evenings of the writing that I've done here on this short story, that terrible inclination to abstract and to analyze. It's not surprising that that's the problem for most young writers. And I hope you can take away from these sessions the conviction, as I have, that the artists, to be an artist, we must bring ourselves intensively back to the primacy of the senses in our perceptions of the world, in the way we understand the world, and indeed in the way that we articulate the world, the way we give it voice, the way we find words to render it into these objects called short stories and novels. So with that little peroration, let's get a couple of the housekeeping things out of the way, as I've done each night. Just for the newcomers, I remind you that the homepage that you came through to find me here in this webcast, that homepage gives you the opportunity to see the archived webcasts from the previous evenings. You can play those at your leisure. And you can also, of course, see the story as it stood on each of the nights, and of course as it stands right now. And very important, you will find an opportunity to email any questions or comments to me. You can do that right now if you're watching this live. And if you're not watching it live, you can do it right now. We receive those emails around the clock, and I have usually my graduate students. Tonight I have my wife, who is looking over the emails that we receive, and I will, at the end of this broadcast, this webcast, try to answer as many of those as I can get to. So do email me with your questions and comments. And you can also find on that homepage a way to look more closely at this postcard. This picture postcard from 1913 of a biplane about to crash. We know it's about to crash because on the back, the person who took the photo and printed it on the postcard backs says, "This is Earl Sant of Erie, Pennsylvania, in his aeroplane just before it fell." That postcard began this story. This is the inspiration for the story. And I think it's time now for us to return to this story, which still does not have a title, by the way, I just realized. I'm inclined to pick up some phrase off of that back of that card. Like before it fell, something, we'll see. As you may know, I'm writing if you were in earlier evenings, I'm writing a book of these short stories. And the two stories that have already been done from postcards, one of which appeared in Hemispheres magazine, the in-flight magazine of United Airlines, and the second of which has not yet appeared, but will appear, I believe it's scheduled for January issue, maybe not, maybe earlier, but anyway, the second story is also going to be in Hemispheres magazine. In those stories, I've taken phrases off of the cards as the title of the stories. And I think certainly that's what I'm going to do here. Which phrase here is the most appropriate and the best sounding title, we're rather limited. I'll entertain your suggestions on that. Which phrase is the most pleasing to the ear and most suggestive for the title of this story? Working strictly with phrases that are in the few words on the back of the card. So here we go. And tonight we will begin, as we have before, by going back a bit and reading aloud. I do this often, as you know, to hear the voice, to see the things that need to be worked on. All right, and this part, since I'm reading aloud, we do in silence. I have Puccini ready to go, as I discovered last evening, and Puccini felt really good to me last night. This, I suspect, I will stay with the highlights of Turandot for the rest of the story, but we'll see. It feels good right now. All right. I turned away, I moved back down the hall, and then stopped, neither here nor there. Matthew's first cousin, Henry, my brother's son, had died of smallpox. My son had already encountered death. Of course he had. We had all encountered death. It was part of our daily lives. Always, we waited for the first sneeze, the first cough, the first spot on our skin. We waited to be carried away, if not from smallpox, then from influenza or from scarlet fever or from diphtheria or from pneumonia or from tuberculosis. I believed in God, that he managed our lives, that he would call us when he chose to. And I was glad my son could picture his blood kin, a child of his own age, as an angel and not as a corpse in the ground. But I stood in the middle of the hallway and I dragged my forearm across my brow and I was having trouble drawing a breath. I waited in bed, sitting propped up in the dark, sweating still. Finally, Rachel appeared in the door, quietly pausing there in the dim light, her white nightgown glowing faintly as if she were a ghost. An unsettling impression. I spoke to her at once to drive the image from my mind. Well, 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 what have we found here? We did a lot of cutting and slashing in this section. I guess that was last night. The impulse to abstract, to analyze, is very strong. And that impassioned little speech I gave at the beginning of this evening's session was not just intended for you. It's even that, even the answers to the questions, even that little speech, those things too are articulations of intuitions and feelings and instincts that are strong in me when I'm writing and conceiving and writing my fiction, and which are the ways in which the fiction gets conceived and gets written. But as strongly as I believe in that, you saw yourselves last night how much abstract crap I had put on the page and had to go back and find later and take it out. And here is a remnant of that, an unsettling impression. It's an abstraction, it's analytical, it's interpreting his own response in a kind of on-the-nose sort of way. It doesn't tell us why he's unsettled, but it's more importantly unnecessary if I've done the rest of my work properly. And of course, the very next sentence is much more direct, much more based on an action and a sense impression, and is entirely sufficient. Finally, Rachel appeared in the door, quietly pausing there in the dim light, her white nightgown glowing faintly as if she were a ghost. I spoke to her at once to drive the image from my mind. Is he all right? I don't know, she said, and she floated this way. By the way, my wife, who will bring the questions up tonight, who Elizabeth Dewberry, who is also a remarkable fiction writer and a wonderful playwright too, she happened, as you have been doing too with your emails, especially in these sections that are all that look, I know, are rough. I mean, you folks have a chance to jump on, and rightly, some of my words even before I have a chance to jump on them, having just put them down. But Betsy whispered that all she had to do was say that phrase to me, and I knew exactly what she was saying, the unsettling impression. And she's entirely right about this. Okay, finally Rachel appeared in the door, quietly pausing there in the dim light, her white nightgown glowing faintly as if she were a ghost. I spoke to her at once to drive the image from my mind. Is he all right? I don't know, she said, and she floated this way. Rachel, I said, yes. She was beside the bed now. I had spoken her name without anything more to say. I just needed to say her name. Nothing, I said. What happened out there? The plane crashed, I said. They aren't safe. Rachel drew back the sheet and sat beside me. Paul, I looked toward her. Her face was there, turned to me, featureless in the dark. She touched my hand and spoke almost in a whisper. What happened? I don't know. I was Earl Sant, sitting in my rattan chair. I looked down and the faces were all turned upward and the mouths all opened to cry out. I move from passive to active here. So let's take the passive out. I looked down and the faces all turned upward and the mouths all opened to cry out, but the only sound I could hear was the rush of air about me as I flew, and the lift was not in my wings, it was in my chest, my very chest. Now, I think these commas are wrong. The sense of flying is a kind of headlong thing. So let's take some of them, if not all of them, out. I could hear, as you know, as I've said before, the comma is a rhythm-making device for me. But okay, let's just take them all out and see if it reads okay. Because we are in a dream here. Right, and then down here when we do the knots, things even within the dream, the sense of perception changes. So let's see how it goes. I was Earl Sant, sitting in my rattan chair. I looked down and the faces all turned upward and the mouths all opened to cry out. But the only sound I could hear was the rush of air about me as I flew, and the lift was not in my wings. It was in my chest, my very chest. I was buoyed up and moving quickly, and there was nothing around me now. Not the airplane, not the rattan chair, only the wide, bright air. I looked down again and there was only one face below and it was my own. Mine. I woke. I sat up quickly, expecting to rise from the bed and up through the ceiling and out into the night sky, but I was awake. I was sitting on my bed. Nevertheless, I lifted my eyes and I saw the aeroplane, its broad wings, the fragile bones holding them apart. holding them in place, holding them apart, is just wrong. It makes them act as if they were trying to be together, and that's not a functional implication. Nevertheless, I lifted my eyes and I saw the aeroplane, its broad wings, the fragile bones holding them in place, the bones stretching behind. To the smaller back wings, the tail, and then one of the wings let go. At the very tip, let go and pointed to the earth, and the aeroplane followed. The front wheel at Earl's feet simply curved down as if finding an invisible slope in the sky. It followed this mountainside quickly downward, and it was gone. And then the sound. I jumped up from the bed, knocking into the bedstand. Okay, I think we're ready to go to Puccini and to the creation of words. This is the part that I'm glad to say some of you have emailed me and said that this part is not like watching grass grow, and I'm glad to hear it, which was the anticipation of some of the things even in print before this began. We're going to move at a different rhythm now, and I may be quiet for a long time. It feels like a place to stop this little scene. He would go back to bed after that. This is one of those moments of cutting. Where does the scene cut to from here? I see them at the kitchen table now, at breakfast. Which now I will slip up out of the trance and say, in a way that I would not otherwise say, but I think what my intuition is perceiving is that the rhythm of this is from what we have now. We have two scenes of the chaos that has been introduced here first in His Son and now in Him. And the rhythm in this story, the tension is between the insistence, the intrusion, the transformative power of what Paul and his son have seen, and the conflict, the tension is between that and Paul's former life, his life that is settled, and it's then true between mortality and life. And I've said way too much under normal circumstances, but glad I've said it for your benefit. Just know that I absolutely would not bring my intuition up to this level of articulation, abstract articulation, if under normal circumstances. Okay, let's get into the kitchen. Okay, I'm off to my Merriam-Webster's Collegiate Dictionary. The one I have recommended to you is the one English American language dictionary, American English dictionary, that tells when words enter the language. And aviator is the word I'm looking for here, you might guess. Huh, 1887. Now that's interesting. Aviator entered the language in 1887, I presume, for balloon pilots, as it were. I do not require silence at the breakfast table. We eat together each day, my wife and my son and my daughter and I, even when my children have one leg skewed out from under the table, ready to run into the summer morning. They have their duties in this house, but the mornings are theirs. It is best to let a child feel his freedom in the morning, and they are free to speak as well. I like to listen to the movement of my children's minds, but this morning there was silence. Long period of silence. And their legs were under the table, and without urging Matthew, without urging, comma, and without urging, Matthew was eating his eggs, studiously sopping up the last bits of yolk with a piece of bread. I had not picked up a newspaper that lay folded beside my plate. I could see in large bold type in the upturned quarter the words "Aviator Killed." It was common for me to read the newspaper at the breakfast table, but only after we had all had a chance. After we'd. He is still speaking here, in a sense. But only after we'd all had a chance to speak of the day to come. I looked at Rachel. She was lifting her coffee cup to her lips, and I could see where her eyes. I could see that her eyes were on Matthew. He was intent on the bread, running it around and around the plate. Naomi was looking out the kitchen door. I followed her gaze. The sun was bright. The trees quaked. A scrap of paper blew across the yard, lifted briefly into the air, and then fell and tumbled along. Even the casual thing here repeats the basic pattern of what has initiated the story and the crisis in Paul's inner life. I placed my hand on the newspaper, but I did not open it. I looked at my hand. It covered the words in the headline. Finally, I said, "It looks like a fine day for play." Finally, I said, "It looks like a fine day out there." Finally, I said, "It looks like a fine day out." Finally, I said, "It looks like a fine day." Matthew lifted his face at this. "Yeah, be excused," he said. Yes. I'm trying to be inside Paul's body right now. This is a terrible gesture for him to see in his son for reasons that I don't want to try to get at right now abstractly, but I just want to feel where he feels this. This must be what it feels like if you believe in ghosts, and if you believe that somehow they summon a strength to knock on a door or push a plate from a shelf. The enormity of the pressure to summon up to do that, you might sense. That's somewhat what it feels like when the writer is now working to feel a gesture in the body of his character that would happen instinctively and subtly. But that you, in your separation from that character, you must summon up all of your concentration to feel it with him. It feels a little like I'm haunting this character. I am the ghost without any longer the physical self to make these things command these objects that I once had commanded. That's from the ghost point of view, but it's analogous to that, I think, in a sense. I'm trying to inhabit this world I'm not a part of. It's a world of this created thing, this thing that's in the unconscious that, as the writer, I'm not. I've got to try to enter it, and it's and you're a wraith. pushed back his chair and he rose, and only now was I hearing the flatness of his request. Matthew lifted his face at this. "May I be excused?" he said. "Yes," he pushed back his chair and he rose, and only now was I hearing the flatness of his voice. He was a boy. This was the moment of the day to be relished above all others. "Maddie," my wife said, "are you all right?" My son had moved toward the door. He stopped now and turned to us. His two shoulders lifted slightly and fell. It was a very small gesture, really, but it made my eyes close so as not to see it. My son had moved toward the door. He stopped now and turned to us. His two shoulders lifted slightly and fell. It was a very small gesture, really, but it made my eyes close so as not to see it. Too late. You see that impulse again to explain. My son had moved toward the door. He stopped now and turned to us. His two shoulders lifted slightly and fell. It was a very small gesture, really. It was a very small gesture, really, this shrug, but it made my eyes close so as not to see it. Too late. This gesture in my son that was not the gesture of a child at all. I opened my eyes. He was pushing through the screen door, not having spoken a word. Okay, that feels much better. Back to words. looking at the word count. We've got over 400 words on that scene, and that feels good. It feels like it needed to be that long. I see him now at work. And at work, he is a man of the world, and at this point, it feels right. I don't know exactly why, but it feels right for me to do a little bit of the research that I do on the fly, as you know. This is a kind of an interesting and useful reference book I have here called Our Times, The Illustrated History of the 20th Century. And I think what I need to do, I just want to see what specifically the historical context is for for Paul at this moment. I'm going to go back 1 year because the events of this is in June of 1913. We know that, and it's to this extent I will because it's useful too. I'm not afraid to change history, especially in matters that don't strike a general reader as inaccurate. But we did learn from our little bit of internet research about Earl Sandt that he died in June of 1913. And I feel the need now, and I think that newspaper probably reminded me of it. Paul has been focused entirely on this event as it played out and his family. But I want to see what else is going on around him and has gone on. So I want to go back 1 year, 1912, and see the year these just passed through, and maybe the first half of 1913, and it's very interesting. Very interesting. I wonder if any of you had thought about this, but just a little over a year earlier, the Titanic went down. And certainly the Titanic has been an obsession of the popular culture ever since, and with a great spasm of it toward the end of the 20th century. That's interesting. And this too, of course, was a kind of modern technology, a kind of new sort of death in a way. Boats, although ships had sunk before, never quite on the scale. I don't want to draw the parallels too much here. The Titanic would be a kind of distraction from this, although it's interesting to know that the Titanic was there. Jung, was doing his work. I'm just looking here to see if anything strikes me. Jim Thorpe, vitamins are identified. The Balkans unite. Marines in Central America. Textile mill workers striking. The Montessori school begins. The Bolsheviks launch Pravda. These things. Ah, here's an. Oh, okay. Another publicized encounter with death in the last days of Robert Scott, who was an explorer into the Antarctic wasteland. And his team was lost. He kept a very famous journal, which was found after he and his people had died. 1913. A lot of this, of course, is just peripheral in the zeitgeist, maybe not even very much in that, as far as Paul would be aware, but it's interesting that Niels Bohr's Quantum Theory of the Structure of Atoms was published in 1913. Avant-garde hits America, D.H. Lawrence. Henry Ford starting to put out 160,000 automobiles a year. Grand Station opens, Grand Central Station in New York City. I'm still thinking that Paul at some point knows height from having gone to New York and up into whatever the skyscraper of the time was. It might have been the Singer Building. I'd have to find that out if that really comes to bear here. He is a banker. He could well have been in New York for some sort of a conference. Prologue to the Great War. The Ottoman Empire at the end of the First Balkan War in May 1913. Members of the Balkan League had taken everything they wanted from the Ottoman Empire. So the Bulgarians craved a piece of Macedonia. The only thing that hadn't been taken. On June 29th, Bulgaria, prompted by Austria, Russia's rival, attacked its two former comrades in arms. So wars in the Balkans. All right. All right. Well, I'm not sure what that has yielded, if anything, but I thought I needed to at least understand a little bit more about the historical context for Paul here. I need to put in maybe another 15 minutes or so of struggling with the words. I would like to get at least the angle of entry established here in this next scene. Ernest Hemingway used to stop every day's writing, and Hemingway wrote for about 2 hours a day in a standing position, interestingly. He did work on a typewriter, I believe, but he would always stop he could even stop in the middle of a sentence. He had to know exactly what was coming next, the next few words, as his hook into the work the next day. I don't have that severe a requirement for myself, but and sometimes I like to stop where the line space comes and work out the new beginning the next day. Sometimes I feel like I want the angle of entry into the next scene so I can keep that flow going, which is a little bit of the impulse that Hemingway had every day. So let's do it. My desk, my mahogany desk, sits beneath the high window, and I've always liked the column of sky looking over me, and I have liked the hush of the bank. It is not blasphemy to say that the hush was like that of a church. We protected the money of the people of this town, and their money was a measure of their hard work, and their hard work rightly gave them the things of this world, the things of a world changing rapidly now. I do not own an automobile. I've always kept a horse, but roads are changing. Monday morning in the year of our Lord, 1913, a desk in a bank. Monday morning in the year of our Lord, 1913, a desk in a bank, a newspaper tucked under my arm and put away in a drawer. I sat and my hands were flat and unmoving on the top of my desk, my mahogany desk, as I sat beneath. Okay. Let's see what we see how this is so far. A Monday morning in the year of our Lord 1913, a desk in a bank, a newspaper tucked under my arm and then put away in a drawer. I sat and my hands were flat and unmoving on the top of my desk, my mahogany desk, and above me was a high window, and I have always liked the column of sky looking over me, and I have liked the hush of the bank. It is not blasphemy to say that the hush was like that of a church. We protected the money of the people of this town, and their money was a measure of their hard work, and their hard work rightly gave them the things of this world, the things of a world changing rapidly now. The hush of the bank and low voices murmuring. The hush of the bank, and there were low voices murmuring, and I knew their words. I could hear terrible, and I could hear aeroplane, and I could hear fire, and I could hear dead. Go about your business. I wanted to cry. I wanted to stand up and tell my tellers. Could hear dead. I wanted to stand up and cry out to my tellers and my customers, go about your business, just go about your business. But instead, I lifted my eyes to the window. Earl Sant's plane hung in the empty sky. All right. $28.70. That's about 653 words tonight. And my general feeling is that the words are good words. I'll have to sleep on it. We'll have to see what they look like tomorrow. But I feel the tension in Earl, in Paul building here. I feel like his inner struggle is gaining power over him. And I think that's where the tension comes in this story. He yearns to reconcile himself to this vision of mortality that has been seared into him in a way that was so new and so shaping that things have been set in motion inside him, and those things are building here. Well, we'll see. I feel good about the words tonight, and we'll work them over tomorrow. All right. Let's go back now to our questions. We have more questions on the way, and here they come. And this is my wife, Elizabeth Dewberry, who I mentioned earlier. Thank you, sweetie. Bye-bye. All right. Tonight, I would like to begin with several questions from one of our more loyal viewers, Eduardo Loureiro, who's watching on the internet down in Fortaleza, Brazil. And Eduardo's first question is, have you ever stopped a story in the middle because you lost the dream space and couldn't get back into the zone again? Eduardo, I'm trying to think of an example where I may have indeed abandoned a story. The larger question is, can one, should one, whether I have done it or not, and I'm trying to think of a story. It's funny about my process. My books of stories, they are books of stories. I don't write individual stories so much as I write in stories that feel as if they are part of some larger gestalt in the book of stories that they're bound for. A Good Scent from a Strange Mountain, my first book of short stories, that book was unified by all of the 15, and by the way, there's a new paperback edition out now where I've added two new stories, and this is put out by Grove Press, but those 17 voices in A Good Scent from a Strange Mountain all are speaking from the Vietnamese diaspora, Vietnamese exiles, most of them living in the United States. The two new stories I've added are in Vietnam, and one of the speakers is not strictly Vietnamese. But anyway, there was a unity to that book in that respect, and I wrote all those stories one after another. Then in Tabloid Dreams, I wrote a book of stories that were based on headlines that I was seeing in the most absurd of the tabloid newspapers, and I began to use those headlines to inspire stories, and made up my own headlines out of the spirit of those kinds of newspapers. So those stories were all written at the same time. These stories are being written around the postcards. What I'm getting around to is I do not remember. Now, I wrote a lot of awful stuff, as I think I've mentioned, literally a million words of it, before I began writing well. And somehow, even when I was writing badly, I almost never abandoned a project. Since I've been writing well, I have a feel for when the character is yearning there. And my impression is that abandoned stories often break down. And I watch abandoned stories happen with my student writers, and I have been watching this for over 17 years. Abandoned stories, I think, tend to be abandoned because of the absence of that central thing I've been talking about from the first session, and that is yearning. It's not the same for a character simply to have problems or attitudes or sensibility or a point of view or a voice. Those are all things that are certainly important in stories, but none of those translates directly into yearning. And it's the dynamics of desire, the dynamics of yearning, that drive a story forward and that constitute an essential part of fiction as an art form. And I think abandoned stories and novels oftentimes, if not most of the time, if not virtually all the time, are abandoned probably because the artist, the writer, is not yet in control of, does not yet really fully intuit the basic yearning of the character, or the character doesn't have a yearning. That's what I'm saying, is not intuiting it yet, which means it's not present in the story. And if you build a story around simply problems and attitude and voice and sensibility and those sorts of things, there's a drift that will set in. And at some point, the writer who truly knows what the art form is about will come to understand that the center of the story isn't there. And when the center of the story isn't there, you must abandon it. Now, when I was writing badly, I didn't understand any of this. Whatever intuitions I had for this, and I've got them strongly now, obviously, but the intuitions that I've finally developed, they just weren't there. They were so embryonic in me that they didn't register. So I didn't have stories abandoned when I was writing badly because they were so bad and I was so much in the dark that I just pressed on through and didn't realize that I should be abandoning the stories. And then once that clicked, once I understood, then I have since then almost never begun a story without having a serious intuitive fix on the yearning of the character. And once that's there, the abandonment of the story becomes a lot less likely. And the absence of yearning, whether it's because you lost the dream space and couldn't get back in the zone again, or chicken or egg question, whether or not not being in the dream space and not really being in the zone let you lose, you know, blinded you to the absence of yearning, whatever, whichever it is, that's what happens. And I think the abandonment of a story had more to do with the absence of the yearning as opposed to losing the dream space, though if you don't have the yearning, you're not going to be able to get into that dream space very deeply. And Eduardo's second question, he asked very good questions. When we are writing, there are often self-distractions, something we remember to do, like the nails to clip that you referred to. I mentioned this phenomenon a few nights ago. Do not the commentaries you offer to us work sometimes as a self-distraction? You're stuck on something, and instead of being willing to clip the nails, you talk to us. Guilty as charged, Eduardo. I think that's quite true. Fortunately, stopping to talk to you, I trust, helps you see into the process. I think there's a benefit to you in my helping, in my stopping and talking to you. But it's probably true as well that your nails may well be too long and need clipping. It's not that the self-distraction, as you call it, Eduardo, doesn't actually accomplish something. So as important to this project as my commentaries are, and I will continue to do them, I think you're very right that you'll find me sometimes only too willing to come out of the dream space and talk to you because I'm in a tough spot. But, you know, I think you benefit from the commentary, and it's something that I need to guard against, that I don't linger in the self-distraction when I go back to the work, and I force myself back to the work quickly after saying only the minimum necessary to illuminate the point for you. And now Eduardo asks the question that I sort of solicited, no one has asked it yet, how to apply the dream storm to writing novels. And I'm going to see if I've got time to talk about this in the 12 minutes we have left. It's a dangerous method, but it's one that can work. The method is this. Now, you know something, I'm looking at that clock and I've got 12 minutes to go. I do not want to interrupt the answer to this question for you. So, Eduardo, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to put this aside for tomorrow. It'll be the first thing I deal with tomorrow. And it will be, as I've mentioned yesterday, I'm going to talk to you then tomorrow night in our question and answer session about how to essentially pre-dream a novel. It's very daunting to face that whole welter of stuff that, and the extraordinarily large number of complex decisions to make a novel adhere to this ideal that I've expressed and that I demand of myself, even with novels, not just short stories, which is to create an object, even if it's a big object, that is totally organic and everything resonates into everything else. And there are writers in the world who are draft writers, and there are writers in the world who do some pre-planning, and I want to give you a method that you might be able to use to pre-plan without letting your analytical mind get involved, and that's the key. So let's put that aside till tomorrow night, Eduardo, when I will have time to finish the answer. Eric Albertson of Edgartown, Massachusetts asks, do you do anything to fuel your unconscious? For example, do you read a piece concerning this period subject just before you go to sleep, or do you listen to period music just before you go to sleep? I see tonight that you're listening to period music. It started last night. I think this question is from then. The Puccini he's referring to. Do you do anything else? Any rituals, such as make a poster out of the postcard and pin it up to your ceiling over your bed? It's a good question, Eric. And there, I don't have anything. Well, you'll notice that the card is here in front of my computer monitor. And certainly that, in this case, that's a kind of very direct, ongoing bit of inspiration. I'm just trying to remember, I often will buy, perhaps I do buy things that have to do with, I do gravitate to objects. I happen to have, I'll be a collector. I love to collect things. And now that you mention it, I've not thought of it this way, but I do buy things around the time I'm working through the, especially the initial inspirations for a book, for a novel or a short story. My new novel is called Fair Warning. It's coming out in late January of 2002 from Atlantic Monthly Press. It's a book about a female auctioneer, and it began as a commissioned short story from Francis Ford Coppola for his magazine Zoetrope, which he runs and publishes. And Francis, through his editor Adrian Brodeur, asked me to write a short story about a female auctioneer because he had become enchanted with Sharon Stone one night, who was acting as the auctioneer for a charity auction, and Francis wanted a story about a female auctioneer in his book, and so they called me and asked me if I would do such a story. Now, from what I've been telling you, you understand that is a kind of external thing that could easily be willed into the story, but I've meditated on it. I got into my dream space. I considered this, and it turned out that pretty quickly the notion of auctioneering, and by the way, in Tabloid Dreams, which I mentioned to you earlier, one of the tabloid headlines that I used, and this was a scoop, I scooped the tabloids on this one, was I wrote a short story called JFK Secretly Attends Jackie Auction. And for that story, I actually went to New York and hung around Sotheby's for a little while, just soaking up the atmosphere. So I knew the world of auctioneering. And it was a it was a occupation that, and if you recall, several nights ago we talked about historical events being useful as a kind of resonant parallel, sensual parallel on the larger scale to the inner emotional patterns of the character in a novel. Well, so too does an occupation resonate in that way. Paul became a banker for good organic reasons. Well, the female auctioneer immediately attached itself to a character that obviously was already ready to go in my unconscious. And so I agreed to that, and I wrote the short story, and then the story did very well, and I redreamed it as a novel. And this is a long preamble to answering what is sort of a simple question, but you bring up an interesting point, Eric, that I had not considered, and so I'm just working my way through to understanding it. And I went on the internet, onto eBay, and just put in the phrase female auctioneer, and lo and behold, it turned out I found a piece of sheet music from 1850-something, 54 or so, and it was called The Female Auctioneer, and by golly, the lyric of this, and I won the auction, and I got this wonderful piece of sheet music called The Female Auctioneer, and it's kind of a very old-looking but typographically rendered cover, and I framed that and kept it near my writing desk. And it's an object. And the important thing about it is it's a physical thing. It's an object. It's a sense-based thing. And a kind of something attended to it. And there are things like that in all the works I have. There's always some object or objects. There are other things, too. That's just an example. Now, in terms of music, the music keeps me, fuels my unconscious while I'm writing. And it's true, when I'm not holding myself to showing you every step of the process in the space of this 2 hours, when I would write for 2 hours at home, I might well, sometime during the day, just sit in my study and put the appropriate music on. I'd put Puccini on, and I might dream through, dream storm, or just dream through, or just kind of sit and just hold in a kind of mantric suspension the work. And that would certainly help to fuel my unconscious. It's interesting, Eric. I don't think I mentioned just doing things just before I go to sleep, but you put your finger on something that's very good. Yeah, I think there's that moment just before going to sleep when we're very open to our unconscious. And yes, I will occasionally I would dream. I will open myself to the world of my work in that kind of circumstance. Although I have to be careful because sometimes the words just start coming to me. And I don't want to, and so I keep a little tiny tape recorder by my bed so that I can get some of those words down. But boy, when that starts happening, I get scared because I don't want to lose the flow of words, that moment of dream inspiration when I'm not in front of the computer. I want to retain that. So I put down as little as I possibly can to remember the image or the moment or the gesture or the sense impression so that I can recapture it on the next day when I'm ready to really let myself go to it. So those are some of the rituals and some of the ways in which those objects and those sensual things can help fuel the unconscious and keep you focused. All right. how do you feel about dreams in fiction? And this is from someone, I don't have the name here. How do you feel about dreams in fiction, or the roles of dreams in fiction? I've talked extensively about the dream space, but the literal dreams themselves, I find having very little role in my fiction. I've never written a story from an inspiration brought to me by a literal nighttime dream. The dream space is truly important, and it is a contiguous country to the land of dreams. But as far as actual dreams are concerned, the dreams that are generated at night, I have never used a dream to generate my work. And indeed, as I've said, I find myself, I tell you folks, I'm not getting a lot of sleep. I wake up, last night I got less than 6 hours, which is very uncharacteristic of me, and I feel fine and refreshed and great and full of energy because my literal dreams become, my actual nighttime dreams become a lot less important when I'm in the dream of artistic creation. So there we are. We've had another wonderful session. I'm excited about this, and I'm excited about having you all back tomorrow night. Please return for our next session of Inside Creative Writing, and we will follow the muse where she leads. Thank you. Good night.